Welcome to Orange Weekly, presented by Crouse Health. Alongside Mike Waters, I'm Brent Axe. Coming up, we'll hear from Syracuse head coach Jim Boeheim on what his defense has to do going forward for Syracuse to remain competitive. Plus, syracuse.com's Mike Curtis will join us for an update on the Syracuse University women's basketball team. Mike, we were supposed to be coming off the heels of a Syracuse-Louisville game Wednesday at the Dome, but yet another COVID postponement. So this is now, what, four games that Syracuse has lost at home because of COVID pauses? Do I have my math right there, or is it three?
No, I think you're right at four. And, you know, they've had six games impacted, and they've been able to either make up or reschedule two of those. So as it stands right now, Syracuse is looking at 16 ACC regular season games instead of the original 20. You know, so, you know, it's 80%. It's not a bad number. What you're really worried about if you're the ACC or any of these, you know, teams within the conference and coaches, is you're worried about any more postponements. You know, what if you go from 16 conference games down to 13 or 14 with another pause in there? Then it becomes a little bit more of an issue. But, you know, right now it's you're just keeping your fingers crossed.
You spoke with an ACC official this week. That story's up on syracuse.com. People want to check it out. So what are we looking at in terms of how they could reschedule it? Will they reschedule it? And you just brought up that number, Mike, of 16. How many teams would have been like, sure, great, I'll sign up for that right now at the beginning of the season, given on how unknown the path was going forward? But this is still going to be really interesting. I guess I'll use that word when we get to the end of the road here, because you're going to have a disjointed amount of teams playing a disjointed amount of games, and they have to figure out who's in the tournament, who's not in the tournament. How are they going to do the ACC tournament? This is going to be fascinating to watch how all the pieces fall together here.
Yeah, you hear a lot of words like nimble and adaptive and, stuff like that. To date, the ACC has, when they could, if a team loses a game and maybe another team has also lost a game or just has an open date, they'll schedule a game for that. If they can reschedule a matchup like they did with Syracuse Notre Dame, they'll do that. What they haven't done to this point, and they really prefer not to, is start like cramming the schedule, you know, wedging a game in, you know, where there's not like quote unquote an opening. You know, they don't want to, like, if a team has a game on a Saturday, they don't want to move that game to Sunday just so they can play a postponed game on a Friday. You know, they're hoping they don't get to that point either. But for now, that's the way they're going forward. So, you know, if you're a Syracuse fan and you're looking at that Syracuse schedule, really right now they're at 16 games and your optimum is 17, because Syracuse is the team with the bye on the last weekend of the regular season. All 14 other teams play each other, so there's seven games. Now, if any team coming down the stretch has to go on a COVID pause that last weekend, Syracuse could slide in and pick up a game against that, you know, the other team that loses a game. So, you know, maybe there's a game there. You know, again, maybe if Syracuse loses another game along the way, that's the game that gets you back to 16. But they really don't want to start moving games around and wedging games in, because they just don't think that creates a fair schedule. They'd rather just go down a game or two rather than make a team play three games in 5 days.
Mike, looking at things on the court right now, there's certainly nothing that identifies Syracuse basketball more than the 2-3 zone defense. And right now it's just not up to the standard you want it to be. They're much better in the second half against NC State, allowing 26 points, but it was that first half when they allowed 47 points. You go back to that Pitt game, they gave up 64 points in a half. There's been some lapses defensively, and Jim Boeheim was pretty blunt about the performance of his defense after that NC State game. Mike, what can help this defense get better? Maybe Barama helps out there. Kadari Richmond at the top of the zone is certainly a good defensive presence. He's amongst the league leaders in steals. But really, is it what it is at this point defensively for the Orange?
Well, I think you hit on two big things there. You know, if Barama is able to come back, and listen, you know, we know when he comes back, he's not playing 30, 35 minutes a game. Right. He's coming, you know, after 2 months of being out and a knee surgery. If he comes back, he's given them 10 minutes, and then maybe that increases to 15 at some point. But then by the end of the season, if he could come back, you know, let's say he comes back Saturday against Clemson, so that gives him a full month. By the end of the season, is he playing 20 minutes a game and being effective? That would be a great boost to this defense, because, Brent, I'm going to hit you with a stat you're not going to believe. Syracuse's 3-point percentage defense is first in the ACC.
I don't believe it. Okay. It's incredible.
I know. The teams are shooting 29% from 3-point range against Syracuse. It's, you wouldn't ever think that. And is some of it off the non-conference schedule with some, you know, teams like Rider and Northeast? Yeah, of course. But still, after 8 ACC games, they're doing a pretty decent job. It's when other teams are able to crack that zone open from the inside.
Exactly.
And that is all part of the zone defense. The zone isn't just about the 3-point line. The zone is about denying the ball to the post. The zone's about being able to defend the post guy and not get killed in the low post, like North Carolina State did to them last Sunday in the first half of that game. I mean, how many times did Jericho Helms get the ball easily at the high post? Too easily. And then before Marek Dolezal could even come up and defend him, you had Manny Bates or one of the other guys slipping down low, and Quincy Guerrier and Alan Griffin were not getting back inside in time to deny that pass. I mean, that's how you end up with 47 points in the first half scored against you. But in the second half, they did a much better job. I do think Kadari Richmond is the key to that, though, because, you talk about denying that ball to the high post. 6'5", long arms, instincts for the game. Kadari's a problem for teams out there. He makes it hard just to even throw the pass. He denies it, just with his size and his length. So, yeah, I think if defense becomes an issue, I think Kadari's an answer. You run him out there and slow that other team down.
Mike, defense is the identifier for Clemson. That seems to be, really what they kind of rest on, what they thrive on at this point. They're coming off an impressive win over North Carolina earlier this week. What else does Syracuse have to deal with when it comes to the Tigers on Saturday?
Well, you mentioned the defense, and you're absolutely right. In recent wins over Louisville and North Carolina, Clemson's allowed 50 points in those games.
Pretty good.
I mean, North Carolina scores 50 and a half against people. They love to run. They couldn't do it against Clemson. But other than that, the big cat, Amir Sims, 6'8", 245-pound senior. He leads Clemson in scoring, rebounds, assists, and blocks. I mean, when's the 6'8", 245-pound lead a team in assists? He did it last year too, all four categories as a junior, first player in Clemson history to do it, and now he's doing it again. Everything revolves around Amir Sims, and so Syracuse is just going to have to be aware of him. He's going to come to the high post. When he doesn't come to the high post, if they run somebody like Clyde Trapp or somebody in there to the high post, it's a Sims that's going to be setting up shop underneath, and he's going to be a problem. And so you're worried about foul trouble with Marek and Quincy.
Well, Mike, thanks to you. Coming up, we're going to hear from Syracuse head coach Jim Boeheim and Syracuse Soundbites, and Mike Curtis will follow that for an update on Syracuse women's basketball.
Again, our offense has not really been the problem this year. I mean, you can always ask for, we could shoot better, I think. We haven't turned it over. We've scored. We've gotten good looks. We've gotten good situations. We got balance, five guys in double figures, and Kadari's right there. But our defense has just got to get better. That's the bottom line. If our defense doesn't get better, we won't win.
And we bring in our friend and colleague from syracuse.com, Mike Curtis, to talk a little bit about the Syracuse women's basketball squad. And a little plug, you can see Mike and I host post-game shows on YouTube Sports and on Facebook after Syracuse men's basketball game. So check that out. Welcome, Mike. And I wanted to begin with this Syracuse women's team. They have quite an interesting trend here. Now, it should be noted, Mike and I are talking before the Orange play on Thursday night. So we'll see if this trend continues. But it's certainly been something to watch in that they start slow but finish fast. What's up with that?
Yeah, Brent, it's really interesting. Syracuse has scored less than 15 points in four of their last five games. And the only time they did score over 15 was when they scored 26 against Pitt. They do have a tendency to want to get Camilla Cardoso involved early. And if they're not doing that, they're trying to get Tiana to be aggressive with her three-point shot. But whatever Hillsman says to his girls at halftime, it's working.
It seems like it. There was one point, didn't he tell the team, if you lose this game, we're going to the NIT? I mean, you can't be more blunt than that if you're Coach Q.
Yeah, I don't know if he was joking or not, but it definitely got the job done.
Well, you mentioned a lot of the talent on this team. Camilla Cardoso has been one of the best freshmen in the country. Priscilla Williams has been amazing to watch. Emily Angstler seems to have a double-double every game. Kiki, of course, in the backcourt. But, Mike, as you know, this all comes back to Tiana. It's been amazing to watch her recover from breast cancer, missing last season, coming back. She gets a foot injury as this season progresses, a 28-day pause due to COVID. But here we are, and Tiana's doing Tiana things at this point.
Yeah, just what she's been able to accomplish this season with everything she's gone through over the past year and a half has been phenomenal. She's averaging 10 points per game, a little under 8 assists per game. That's top in the ACC and second in the whole country. I mean, if we looked back a year ago, I don't think any of us would have imagined her having this type of season. And I think the Orange is in a pretty good position to do well for the rest of the year.
Yeah, Tiana, once again, a candidate for the Lieberman Award, the best player in women's college basketball. Well, thanks to Mike Curtis for joining us here on Orange Weekly. Thanks to Mike Waters, and thanks to you for watching. It's all been presented by Crouse Health. We'll talk to you next time.